click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ekeeda.
Hello friends, welcome. Guys, till now we have seen different types of aesthetic aspirations, then the product development things. We have seen different aspects of product design, the important things that are important, the important things which are associated with manufacturing processes and all. Today we are going to look at a very basic thing in this particular session, which is stresses, different type of stresses. Let us begin. We already know many types of stresses, but we haven't think of them in the light of design stresses. Let's start with it. We know different types of stresses and we know how to find out their values. But do we know what is the origin of each and every kind of stress? Yes, we are going to look at them. In first session, in the first part, we are going to look at the stresses, types of stresses, and the second part, lateral part, we will try to learn how to identify in which part of the product what kind of stress is induced. So, very first stress that I am going to talk about is your normal stress. Let us designate this stress by the letter sigma. You can designate it with letter P also, you can designate it with letter Q also. But let us go for sigma as far as normal stresses are concerned. Guys, whenever there is a cross section, so whenever there is a cross section of this kind and a force acts normal to it. Let us say cross section area is A. In all such cases, the stress value will be given by, it's a very simple relation, right? All such kind of stresses are called normal stresses because the force acting right now is normal to the area of cross section. Now there are two possibilities. In one case, we see that there are two pull forces acting on the body. In such case, the stress induced will be called tensile stress, and we will designate it as sigma t. In second case, the only thing that is changing is the direction of force acting. Even this area we will call A. Let me highlight the area for your better understanding. In such case also, your sigma will be given by P upon A. The only thing is the direction of force is different. And hence it will be called compressive force or compression. We will designate it with letter sigma C. Is there any difference? The only difference is being elongating and contracting. So they are different only in direction and not in magnitude. So what I am trying to say is, if the same amount of force is acting on the same area A, if the direction is outward, it will be tensile stress, and direction is inward, it will be compressive stress. These both stresses are called normal stresses because the forces are acting perpendicular to the area of cross section. Fine. Now, what is the significance of these stresses? These stresses are useful when the body is subjected to the forces in such a way that in the small part of the area or small part of the product, the force will be perpendicular. In such cases, we will identify the product as product failing under normal stresses. Of course, in next session, we are going to deal with it in detail. Let us move ahead and go for the second type of stress. Shear stress. Guys, we know that when shear takes place in between two planes, adjacent planes in a body, it calls shear failure. So the stress that opposes this failure is called shear stress. For example, These are two bodies which are held together by means of a rivet. Now these two bodies are held with rivet, and let me apply some force. In such case, one body will try to move on the right side and another body will try to move on left side. So rivet is the only thing that is trying to keep them together. Somehow, if the magnitude of force is large enough, the rivet cannot sustain the applied load. In that case, rivet will fail. But how the rivet will fail? This is how the failure of rivet will happen, in which the upper part of the rivet will be taken on left side and the lower part will be dragged on the right side. So the shear is actually happening in this area. In short, this particular area is sheared off, and that's why the resistance which was given by this particular area to the forces applied is called shear stress. There are many letters we can use for that. Of course, one letter is sigma, S, then they call it tau, and there is another letter Q. We will prefer tau letter for this shear stress. So hereafter, shear stress will have the same value as that of the normal stresses. But the only thing here changing is the area on which the force is acting. If you see properly, since this particular area is being sheared off, so this area we must consider for calculating stress. In earlier case, the force which was acting on particular area we considered for finding out stress. In this, we are considering the area which is getting sheared off. The value of force will be same as that of previous, and the same value I am going to use here. Right? So that is about shear stress. Let us move ahead and look at next type of stress, that is bending stress. Now, whenever a beam is subjected to, let me write bending stress as the name. So, whenever a beam, no matter what kind of support it has, is subjected to transverse loading. When I say transverse loading, it looks like this. What is the ultimate state of this beam? Let us say this is the neutral axis of the beam. Ultimately, this beam will be deflected like this due to the action of force P. Now, if you look at the cross section of the beam, let us say this is the cross section of the beam. If I enlarge it and see it properly, I'll find that only neutral axis will remain as it is. All the axis above neutral axis will be in compression. Of course, we know this thing before. So all the things will be in compression above the neutral axis, and all the things below neutral axis will be in tension. Why? Because when the beam is bent, in that case, it is assumed that the upper portion tries to come closer, whereas the lower portion gets some sort of elongation. So, whenever there is some sort of elongation, the lower part I will assume to be in tension, and the upper part, since there is some compression, I will call it compressive stress. So, what is the difference in bending stresses and normal stresses? In bending stresses, the direction of force that acts is transverse, whereas the stresses generated are normal. So the only thing is the direction of force is different as that of normal. The magnitudes. In this case, if I have to plot the diagram for this, it will be given in this manner. So these are nothing but the intensities of stresses induced. Upper part compressive, lower part tensile. What are the formulae? there are separate set of formulae that we use for bending stresses. We already have learned this, we already have used this particular part. So, bending stresses, no matter whether it is tensile or compressive, bending stresses will be given by this particular formula. Whereas, M is the maximum bending moment. I is the inertia, area inertia, which is the inertia of this particular area. And the distance of extreme fiber from the center point, that is half the length or half the height of the area. So this is nothing but Y. Once you know all three parameters, you can find out bending stress. Let me repeat, the upper portion will be in compression, lower portion will be in tension. If the given area is symmetric about both the axes, the values of sigma c and sigma t is going to be same. So this was our third kind of stress. Let us move ahead and look at the one more aspect of important stress, and that is called principal stress. Guys, let there be an object which is under the influence of forces. I am considering only very small element of that particular object. So this is just enlargement of small element. Let the situation be such that there are no shear stresses acting on its edges. What I mean is, on this edge, there is no shear force acting. On this edge, there is no shear force acting. Same for this. In such a case, this particular planes, see, these are the whole plane which is going inside the page. So, in this particular plane, there is absence of shear stress. In such a case, sigma 1 is called principal stress. If the same condition is valid for sigma 2, guys, try to understand. This is a plane which is going inside. So, on this plane, if there is no shear stress, sigma 2 will also called as principal stress.
So, we are discussing about the principal stresses. Like I said, when there is absence of shear stress on one plane, that particular stress or that particular plane is called principal plane. No doubt that the stress acting at that moment at that particular plane is called principal stress. Same condition happens in case of second thing. The only difference between sigma 1 and sigma 2 here is sigma 1 is always larger in the value. It will be greater in the value. Sigma 2 will be smaller than sigma 1. Why it is important? Guys, if you see properly, the planes on which sigma 1 and sigma 2 are acting, they are at right angle. And hence, there is a difference between them. Now that need not to be sigma 2 is vertical, not necessary. Sometimes sigma 2 can take the position of sigma 1. What I am trying to say is, one of the planes on which shear stress is 0, those planes will carry two stresses and they will be called principal stresses. One of them will be always larger in value, second of them will be smaller in value. Of course, this depends upon externally applied loads also, but that calculation part will take care while we will be solving numericals. So, this was from my side about the design stresses. What I am trying to say is, let me conclude. Guys, whatever parts we are going to design in machine design 1, those parts will be subjected to this kind of stresses. The stresses can be normal stresses, they can be shear stresses, they can be bending stresses, or they can be principal stresses. Based on the stresses which are acting on them, of course, we are going to identify them. After identifying, we will design the particular part for this kind of stresses. Means, we will design the part in such a way that the part will be able to handle the stresses. And since part will be able to handle the stresses, the part will be safe. So that is what our ultimate goal is. Thank you so much for watching the video. If you like this video, please subscribe to Ekeeda. Thank you.